community leader, a featured lecturer in several large TV channels, and a little tidbit about his hobbies is that he loves mixed martial arts, archery, and skydiving, which is a big martial arts movie, but anyways. Enough of my lip rambling. Let's have over so they might have you come to the stage.
How many people like skydiving? 3-4 hands. I'm not condoning it because I know this is being recorded and parents will kill me if I condone it. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this a blessed gathering and allow us to benefit from what we hear. I'll be speaking for about 11 minutes and 30 seconds, inshallah, so pay very close attention. Every few days, or every week, on average, throughout the year, I'll receive a call from a masjid, a board member from one of the Islamic centers in this country, or others, and they'll ask for advice about how to engage the youth in their community. How do we bring more youth to our masjid? How do we get youth to volunteer? One of the brothers mentioned, for example, he's like, they have a state-of-the-art gym. We have a multi-million dollar property. We have everything that youth should possibly want, but we don't have any youth coming to the masjid. I said, the problem is not with the youth. Every now and then, we're faced with this question that we should ask ourselves, regardless of who you feel you are in the community, you are part of the community. The question of, why am I not more engaged? No matter how engaged you are, no matter how religious you are, no matter how active you are or not, we ask ourselves this question for the sake of getting closer to success, attaining something that is beneficial for us in this life, and especially in the next life. While we are somewhat a young and new community in this country, the Muslim community is still developing. We've come a long way, alhamdulillah. A lot has changed. The previous problem that we had is kind of disappearing now, the problem of what? Needing more masajid. Now we have, alhamdulillah, so many masajid, Islamic centers, thousands across the country. But now we have the problem of what? A lack of engagement. So we are focusing on what? Development. We are focusing on developing people. We are focusing on building our generation and the next generation and looking far ahead 500 years down the road at those generations. So, one of the board members, when he brought up this matter, he says, we do have youth in the community. The problem is not that we have youth in the community or that we have a gym or that we have a major masjid. He said, we come to pray and there are no youth praying. Everyone who's praying in the masjid, he says, or Fajr prayer and Isha, he said, everyone who's praying is extremely old. And the youth, we feel that we are not doing the right things to bring them, to feel a task, to bring the house of Allah. During that particular conversation, we kept reflecting on one verse, and the one verse I want you to remember. The beginning of it, in Surah Al-An'am, verse 103. وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. And hold firmly to the rope of Allah and do not divide. He says the youth in our masjid, when we ask them directly, like I'm asking you right now, why are you not more engaged? He says, when we ask them why they're not engaged, he says, you guys have too much politics. You guys keep fighting, referring to the board. You guys keep dividing. You cannot handle one another. Why do you want us to even get involved in your politics? They're being very frank, very honest. The reality is, when we think about the power that we have, all of that power diminishes when we're divided. Our power is in the collective. Our power is in unity. Our success is in unity. We forget about the importance of engaging with the local community. We forget that every single person here, regardless of your age, regardless of your background, every single one of us here has a significance in our ummah. Do not ever allow anyone in the masjid to make you feel like you don't belong. Don't ever allow someone in the masjid to make you feel like the masjid is not welcoming to you. The problem is not with the rulings of Islam. The problem is not with our understanding of Islam. The problem is with the person who's not being welcoming to the entire community. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us unity and to make us welcoming in our communities. The reality, however, is that the response that we have to the different issues that are taking place, to the politics that are taking place, is a response that is not justified. What do I mean by this? If you are somebody who has a local Islamic community, and you have a masjid or multiple masjids, and you have a da'wah organization like this one here today, and you have the opportunity to engage, to be part of the jama'ah, the unity and the community of the entire ummah, and you say, I don't want to because there are too many politics, because it's too divided. The reality is, what we're really saying is, I'm not patient enough to sacrifice this. I'm not willing to make it better, so I'm going to step back. Are there some cases in which you really cannot do anything and you should step back? Absolutely. But in most cases, we are not willing to handle what's happening around us. And it's easy for us to go on social media and to criticize what's happening around the world. It's easy for us to be armchair critics, to post online, to share statuses, and the reality this is a very common thing. But how many of us are willing to be patient, to work with other organizations, to work with other team members who might have different views? Let me ask you a question. Everyone here who has any family member or relative, how many people here have some family members who do not have the same views as you on every single thing in life? Yes, some people have family that agrees with everything, mashallah. I'll give you an example. I'll give you a minor, insignificant, perhaps silly example. Ice cream or chocolate? Ice cream or chocolate? How many people prefer ice cream over chocolate? How about chocolate over ice cream? Allahu Akbar. Android or Apple? How many people prefer Apple over Android? How many people prefer Android? MashaAllah. Hey, what guy is also Android? I'm kidding. Raptors or Warriors? Or you guys like, you don't really care. Raptors deserve to win, right? I'm gonna get hurt for that. Why am I asking this? You have different views than your family about many things. Does Allah expect you to have the same views? Yes or no? Does Allah expect you and your family to have the same views on every single thing in life? Yes or no? No, absolutely not. Does Allah expect you to stay united as a family? Yes or no? Absolutely. So we can have differences. The objective is not necessarily to agree on everything. We have to be willing to work with one another, to unite with one another, in spite and despite our different views. We have to be willing to work on boards and organizations and volunteer with people who hold different views, so long as we're doing what's right, so long as the objective is something pleasing to Allah. The objective was never necessarily to agree on every single thing, even within the folds of Islam. There are different approaches and different views. The objective is to work with one another, not to have conflict and enmity in our communities. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us the people who are always looking for unity, for resolution, for mediation, for ourselves and for the people around us. So regardless of your views on chocolate being better than ice cream, or Android being better than Apple, or the Raptors destroying the Warriors, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to see beyond minor and major differences and to work with our families and with our communities. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the most beloved people to Allah are those who are most beneficial to others. If you want to increase changing the world in your life as part of your objective, you have to know how to work with others. You have to stick to your community even when things get difficult. We're looking at people getting shot for being black. We're looking at people dying because they're migrating for something that is better for them. We're looking at people who are being ethnically cleansed in East Turkestan under the oppression of China. We're looking at brothers and sisters for more than 70 years being killed and occupied in Palestine. We have problems affecting people from the East to the West, and every one of us knows that if I stood here today listing the number of problems of injustices and oppression, we would be listing country after country after country after country, the causes of countless. What is the point behind this? The point is that if we're not willing to work with other people while we're in the safety and security of this country, what are we sacrificing when they are sacrificing their lives? When they are dying for being a certain way, or living in a certain country, or growing up in a certain environment, or with a certain skin color, or certain ethnicities, they are sacrificing their lives. What are we sacrificing when we work for a global organization and people have differences? We have to be able to handle more. We have to raise our standards of patience. And I know that might sound a little harsh, it might sound a little stern. The reality is our volunteerism, our service, our community, our connection, our unity is what will change our ummah. Our community is projected to be the largest religious population in the world by year 2070. I don't believe this projection. In fact, I believe by 2048, 2050, Muslims will be the largest religious population in the world, but this does not matter. Because it's not about the quantity in this case, it is about the quality. If we have a quality, collective voice working with each other, despite our differences, if we have a quality in our unity, do you think Palestine will still be occupied in 30 years? Do you think there will still be problems of racism and injustice at these levels we see today? But we are simply divided. And the concept of divide and conquer, we are seeing it live every single day in the United States and around the world. There are people whose agendas are successful because they know how to divide amongst us. They know how to divide Americans, they know how to divide Muslims, they know how to divide between the black and the white, the Arab and the non-Arab. Are we foolish enough to fall for these divisions? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to see with proper vision the objective of unity and the objective of success. My brothers and sisters, as I wrap up my last 3 minutes, inshallah, the reality is we have to have something called strategic foresight. If you've heard of futures study, which is the study of the future, there's a discipline within it, which is strategic foresight. This is for someone to be looking ahead and to avoid the harm that they see, the threats that they see, so that they can attain their goal or objective. If you have a goal in life for yourself, your family, your community, an organization you serve, or a company that you work for, that objective has to have multiple routes. This is strategic foresight. So you're always looking ahead. I'll give you an example to understand as I wrap up my last minute and a half. How many people here drive? Now I want you to be 100% honest. How many people here who drive have driven and texted at least once in their life at the same time? Yes? May Allah guide you and guide me and guide all of us, especially if you're using iPhone. May Allah guide you. Now, what's the problem with texting and driving? We already know. I know, you know, we all know the problems. We know how many people have died, the messages that they were texting as they died. Somebody on Snapchat, it means sister on Facebook. We see these things all the time. Why am I bringing this up? The one who's driving and they're texting constantly, they're not seeing the signs ahead that there's something happening. So they don't have enough of the reaction time to the danger before it hurts them. For us to look ahead 30 years down the road, where is the American Muslim community going to be? On your shoulders. And the next generation, and the one after that. 50 years down the road, we have to look ahead. If you want to look ahead, you have to be willing to work with others. You have to be willing to realize that if you are a true leader, that you don't have to be a follower. A true leader is also an effective team player. And if we want to change the world as we claim, and we desire, and we hope for, then we have to be willing to work with one another for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبِّ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. Unite and hold fast and firm to the rope of Allah, the Qur'an, the goal, the perspective, the paradigm of Islam. Hold firm to the Qur'an. It will unite you and bring you together. And do not divide amongst yourselves. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us people who are united and working for unity. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us in our communities to that which is successful in this life and the next life. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect you and I from ever dividing between people and communities. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala use all of us for the greatest level of success for our ummah in this life and in the next life. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.